Going now.
Hey, we're going. We're off.
Hey.
So welcome everybody to NCO's webinar. It's fantastic to see you all here. I can see you all joining fast. We've got 59 already and it's climbing super fast. So I just have to talk a little bit while everybody comes into the space so that we know that everybody's here before we start. So I will start with a little bit of housekeeping. We have two amazing guests with us today, as you can see. In order to ask them questions, you just go down to the bottom of the screen to the Q&A button, tap on that, type in your questions. And we have the fabulous NCO team in the background sorting through all your questions and sending to me so I can ask them to our guests. We're probably going to have loads of questions, I imagine, so apologies in advance if we don't get through all of them. In fact, we've already got one, my goodness. I don't know what that is. So also there's going to be some polling so we can find out some secrets that you won't be able to find out anywhere else about these amazing people. And we are going to take a fantastic webinar selfie as usual at the end. So can you think of any props that you might want or any poses that you might want to do, and we'll get ready for the webinar selfie. Ooh.
Sorry, that's me. It's all right.
Okay, so Bill, you can't contain yourself. I'm going to do one of the things that I find quite awkward about these webinars is that there's never a big entrance moment for you guys. Specifically, it's not like, you know, when you're on a chat show and you come down the stairs and there's an orchestra and a band and a choir and the audience clapping and so I did a very I've created a very tiny little welcome thing for you. Okay.
Oh,
so sit back and enjoy my welcome. Here we go. Let's see. Everybody's here, I think. So off we go. We're going to welcome our guests.
I would never ever be able to have done that.
No, that was knockout. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I've spent all day yesterday trying to make that work.
Oh,
so I'm so glad it worked. And just a little word to all of you guys out there. My Wi-Fi has been really on the blink today. So if I disappear for any reason, Bill and Tam are going to keep talking and Sophie Lewis, our managing director, is going to come running out of the darkness and save the day. But fingers crossed, we are all going to be fine. So you guys know each other. Tell us a little bit about working together on Black Books. Go, Bill.
Well, that's right. We worked together on three series of Black Books, and I played the character of Manny, and Tamsin played the character of Fran. And we had interesting surnames, didn't we? My surname was Manny Bianco, and Tamsin's character was Fran Katzenjammer, which we figured out was German for hangover. So,
which apparently, when Dylan Moran, who wrote the show and also plays Bernard Black in the show, when he was working out the names, he apparently didn't know that Katzenjammer was a hangover.
No.
He thought it was just a word, but because...
Just a funny name, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it works both ways. Anyway, we worked with three series, and it was a lot of fun. It was one of the most joyous experiences I can remember on any kind of artistic endeavour. And of course, it was a great joy to work with a proper actress like Tamsin, who kept us all in line when we tried to sort of make her laugh.
Okay, so talking of proper actresses, let's have a little look at Tamsin and her career. Talk us a little bit through these four things, Tam. This is just a very small selection of the things that she's done.
Okay, so top left, that's me with Stephen Mangan and a little-known American actor called Matt LeBlanc, who we did a show called Episodes about two Brits going over to America and being forced to have Matt LeBlanc playing himself, Matt LeBlanc, in our comedy. Below that, that's me at playing Beatrice at the Royal Shakespeare Company in Much Ado About Nothing. Diagonally up the National Theatre at home, I did a production of Twelfth Night in which I played the character of Malvolio, which was done for the first time ever as Malvolia. So we played it as a woman. And then below that, in the bottom right, that's me with Paul Ritter, Tom Rosenthal and Simon Bird in the show on Channel 4 called Friday Night Dinner, which we've done 6 series of.
Amazing. And tell us about this, Tam.
Oh, this was the most frightening thing I've ever done in my life, apart from jumping out of a plane, which I've done a few times. But this was when I was in a musical, the first musical that, and last musical that I have ever did and will do. It was a stage version of Pedro Almodovar's movie, Women on the Verge of a Nervous Breakdown. And it actually did take me to the actual verge of a nervous breakdown. And I had to learn to sing. I was already a dancer, so that was all right, but I had to learn to sing. So I spent 18 months learning to sing to do that. And it's the most frightening thing I've ever done, but also the most thrilling, apart from being with Bill Bailey, obviously.
Obviously.
And Bill, tell us about these things that you've done in your life.
Right. Well, there we go. Okay. Well, let's see. Let's start with the bottom left. That's me. I was asked some questions by Classic FM. I think you can probably see the logo there. And it was just sort of interesting questions about music, which I responded to with a piano. And that was actually quite fun. It was things like, what's your favorite melody? What's your favorite key? What kind of music do you associate with places, people, that sort of thing? So quite interesting questions, and I very much enjoyed that. You can watch that on YouTube if you like. And then above that, there's me playing a preposterous guitar, which actually has 6 necks. I don't even count them all. And it was a gift from my wife, a birthday present. And I felt then obliged to try and play it on stage. And this was me at the Albert Hall, actually, at a gig where I performed with the band Deep Purple. And just before they came on, I went on stage with this 6-neck guitar. And I've got to tell you, it looks impressive. It's devilishly hard to play, because the thing is, your arms aren't long enough to get to the bottom of the bottom neck. So you can only play the top 3 necks. And then actually it was quite funny, because Prince Charles was the patron of the charity that we were performing for, and he came to visit us before the show. And I had the guitar on my neck and I was playing it, and he was saying, "This quite difficult to play, isn't it? Do you have a fake arm? Do you use a fake arm?" and I was sort of thinking, is he actually making fun of me? And then I thought, actually, that's not a bad idea, actually. Have like a fake arm down the bottom, and then... Anyway, so that's that. And then the photograph on the top right is me performing at Edinburgh Castle on stage with the BBC Symphony Orchestra, I think that was. And that was part of a sort of a series of live events. And I think what I'm doing there, I'm playing the BBC News theme with the full orchestral backing. And as you can see, it was quite a misty night. It was sort of quite a rainy, misty night in Edinburgh. So I don't think the audience could actually see me, but they could certainly hear me. Anyway, and then below that is an image of me with 2 French horns stuck to my forehead. And that was actually the logo that was on the used as the DVD I made, Bill Bailey's Remarkable Guide to the Orchestra, where I sort of devised a show with Anne Dudley, who's a brilliant composer, used to be in the band Art of Noise. And we wrote this show, The Remarkable Guide to the Orchestra. And the idea was to try and sort of show the workings of an orchestra and the textures of the sound within it, and to sort of deconstruct it a little bit and have a bit of fun along the way. So, that's those 4.
Great, fantastic. And I've just got a couple more there for you, Bill. TV stuff, look. You do a lot on TV now.
Yes. Well, on the left is me as the character of Bagpipes in the TV comedy In the Long Run, which was created by Idris Elba, who you can see in the middle there. He plays the character Walter. And it's a sort of set in the 80s, and it's a sort of family comedy drama about on an estate in the East End of London. And on the right hand side, my right, is me appearing in the show QI. And that, I think there's Alan Davis, Joe Brand, Stephen Fry, James Acaster, and myself, which is always a lot of fun and a great TV thing to be involved in.
Fantastic. Great. So I'll come out the screen share now. We've already got a question in from Eleanor, perhaps for you, Bill. Who are some of the most interesting people that you have worked with? That's a bit of a
Well,
loaded question.
yes. Well, of
So
course,
now,
Tamsin
who
Greig. She's
yes,
interesting.
thank you
She's
very
one,
much.
I mean, Tamsin Greig, who by chance is here with us, one of the most interesting people ever. She's interesting. And then who else I've met? I worked, well, Anne Dudley, she's very interesting. She's fascinating. She started out, with this sort of 80s, sort of like an electronic band, The Art of Noise, and they experimented with sound and sampling and live sampling. And then she really went on to become a sort of a composer in her own right. And now she's one of the most celebrated composers of TV and film soundtrack. She recently did the soundtrack to the TV series Poldark, and she's done countless Hollywood films, and it was fascinating working with her, because she's very, I mean, I'm Tamsin will agree with this and say that I'm perhaps a little bit undisciplined and a bit sort of scatterbrained, and but what she brought to that was she's very disciplined and brought a sort of rigor to the work, which I really enjoyed. I had to sort of, every session we did, I would just jam away on the piano, and she would record it all and say, "Oh, now we have to go and burn that to a disc and listen to it tonight. That's your homework." It's like, "Oh, okay, I like this way of working." So it seems fascinating.
Great, thank you, Bill.
And yeah.
Sorry, just so to move on now, we could you think both of you yourselves back to the kind of age that our children are at NCO, so they're between 7 and 14, and Tam, could you tell us what you were like at 7 and 14, what you were doing with your life?
Well, when I was 7, the thing that I wanted to be was a ballet dancer, and so I did lots of ballet and thought that's what I wanted to be. I also tried to learn the. Oh, look, there we are. So, can you see that? So there's a picture of me at ballet. That was, I think, when I tried to get into the Royal Ballet School, and I didn't get in because at that they knew I was going to be too tall. I mean, how weird is that? From that photo, they knew I was going to be too tall. But anyway, and then that's also my first performance ever. So I think I was about 6 there, and I was in the school nativity play in my infant school, playing the very, very well-known part in the nativity story of the Roman soldier.
I can see that.
That on your head there, Tam? Is that a lampshade with silver foil on it or something?
No, that's a Roman centurion's helmet.
That's no, but that's exactly that's the historically accurate costume. That's
It
exactly what they wore.
and they also had sideburns that were
Yeah,
attached to their
very
helmet,
much so.
which was a protection for their chiseled cheekbones.
Yeah.
I remember at the time thinking, first of all, why have they cast me in a male role? And that seems to have been the kind of theme of my career. But also, I do remember the line. But can you see, if you just have a look down, if you look down sort of towards the middle of the picture, there is a young lad looking at me. I don't know who that was, but the look on his face is, why is she so loud?
Oh, yes.
Because I think I was given the part because I had such a loud voice. And I remember the line that I was saying. The line was, names, 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 it's enough to drive a Roman soldier up the wall. That was it. And I mean, the nativity story of the birth of the baby Jesus wouldn't have been the same without him.
And he's looking around going, Got it. Keep it down. She's loud.
There's a baby asleep here. You have to just shush.
Yeah.
So, Tam, you had ballet in your life. Did you have music in your life?
So, yes, I tried to learn the piano, but we had quite a frightening piano teacher who used to come to our house.
We've got a picture here. We've got a picture of him. What was his... No, you probably shouldn't say what his name was, should you?
He was quite frightening. And when I got a note wrong, he would just go, no. He wouldn't say what the correct note was. He'd just go, no. So I was just desperately trying to get the note. But he was also quite off-putting. This cartoon was drawn by my sister when we were much younger. He was also quite off-putting because he farted quite a lot during lessons. So I'd be playing and he'd go, no. Just like little... like that. And I'd be playing and go, and he'd never say anything and I'd never say anything. And it was excruciatingly embarrassing. And so I had to stop. So I never learned the piano because of his...
Phil, father. Could you give us a little bit of a soundtrack of that, what that might sound like there?
Yes. Well, this looks like your arms are out like this. It looks like you might be playing Fair Elisa. Shut up. Something like that.
That's exactly it. I'm having flashbacks. I'm feeling a little bit hot and sweaty now. We're going to have to stop.
So tell us about you, Bill. What were you up to when you were like 7 to 14, that kind of age?
Well, I was learning the piano and the guitar at school. And I was in all the school plays. I was around about the age of, what was I? Probably 12 or 13. We were in a very ambitious production of The Resistible Rise of Arturo Uy, which was in the Bertolt Brecht play, which was an extraordinary. We had a very an English teacher who was very keen on these kinds of things, and I played the main character, obviously. And there was one scene where a gun had to be fired, and this chap, I remember his name is Adam, I can't remember his name anyway. He held up this toy gun, and he would fire like this, and there was a sound effect of the gunfire that the sound person had to press a button. So he pulled up the gun like this, and he pressed a button, and it would go like that. Except that he missed the cue, so there was no sound. So what he did was, He pulled the trigger as you would, you know, instinctively, but it was a toy gun. So it just made this pathetic little beep, 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 sort of like weedy little toy noise. And then that's it. We all started laughing and then we couldn't stop laughing then. And that was sort of, it kind of, the whole play just sort of kind of disintegrated. But it was good fun. And then I was quite sporty actually. I played a lot of sport. I played in the cricket team, and I played obviously learned the piano, and I played in the school band, and we had a band had a band called the Behind Closed Doors, we were called. And we played lots of we rehearsed in my front room at home, and so I was quite musical, quite sporty, bit of a swot, you know. I like to study quite a bit. And I was until probably about the age of 16, and then I ended up in showbiz. But other than that, it's gone very. It was good fun. It was a fascinating. It was a lovely time. I remember just loving being able to play instruments. You know, like different instruments. You know, at school they had a music room, and it was full of different wild and wonderful things. So, lots of music, lots of reading, being quite sporty and studying quite a lot.
Perfect recipe. So,
like one of those annoying people that could, like, do everything. Just sort of a bit, brilliant, but a bit annoying. Is that the case?
Well, I mean, you know, you say that. I don't think I was. I think I was just, I was understatedly brilliant.
Right, so the main question we're going to try and discuss in amongst the joking and fun is, what can musicians learn from actors? Okay, Bill, you kind of straddle both worlds as a musician and an actor and a comic and all sorts of things. How would you answer that question? What can musicians learn from actors?
Well, I think that really, I mean, you're both involved in performance a lot of the time. I know that sometimes musicians are in a part of an ensemble, or they're playing with other musicians, or in an orchestra, and there's sometimes there's a tendency I've noticed amongst some musicians, not all, that they just like to focus on the music and the notes and not really be aware of the fact that there's an audience there. But I think that actually what they can learn from actors is very much to acknowledge the fact the audience are there, to have a bit of, I don't know, a bit of stage presence maybe, to sort of be aware of them, to maybe actually, look like you're enjoying it, look like you're actually getting involved with it. And I think also just performing, I mean, actors, I don't know what you say, Tamsin, but there's a kind of, you sort of put on a bit of a persona when you get on stage. You have a bit of a little bit of armor. You sort of get out there and you feel a bit more confident. I think confidence is a great thing, and I think that that's perhaps something that that musicians could sort of learn: confidence and stage presence.
Oh, look, we've got our first poll. Thank you, Bill. That's really
Oh.
valuable. Our first poll, we can all vote on this, is about some secrets about Tamsin, whether they're true or false,
All
okay?
right.
In her school days, she won prizes for trampolining. Tamsin has a plant named after her. Tamsin has done 10 parachute jumps. Tamsin can drive an HGV, which is a massive lorry. Or Tamsin is a trained lifeguard, okay? So have a vote on all of those while I go back to Tam and say,
Sorry.
ask you, Tam, about the fourth wall thing in drama, because it's something that musicians don't talk about. Could you tell us what the fourth wall is?
So the fourth wall is basically the idea of if you think of the stage as being a box, and so you have the wings and the backdrop are sort of three sides of the box, and then the fourth wall is where the audience is sitting. So generally in theatre, up to probably the mid sort of 19th century, the fourth wall was an actual wall, so that the performance went on behind that wall, and the audience were to a degree ignored. So from that point on, interestingly, through the Industrial Revolution and all of that change that was going on in society and things shifting around, the fourth wall then became sort of like gossamer, like it became thin, so that the audience and the performance were then actually in some sort of communication, which then developed into the 20th century, often where performances were, took place within the audience, and then the audience space was turned around so that you would have audiences sitting in different ways within the building. But it's really about acknowledging that there is a communication that goes on between those people on stage or those performing and those participating through witnessing what's going on. And it's about that communication. So the fourth wall can often be a barrier, a hindrance to that communication. And performance, whether it's acting or playing music, is about telling the story and really about connecting with the heart of the other person. That's really at its essence what it's about, is the heart is trying to connect with the other heart. That sounds a little bit weird, but really the best stories are about those things that connect with the heart. So the fourth wall is about engaging with what cuts us off from one another's hearts. That's probably quite a complicated answer.
It's an amazing answer. Thank you so much. Now the poll results are in. So let's see, I'll share the results of them and we'll see what people thought. Can you see that now? 70% think that you won prizes for trampolining at school. Is that true?
That is true.
Brilliant. Well done,
Yes.
everybody. Tamsin, 57% think you have a plant named after you. Is that true?
If I do, I am unaware of that. I hope it is.
Oh.
Don't go there, Bill. Not yet. Don't go there yet.
What?
Know what you're thinking. Don't go. Yeah, don't go there. Tamsin has done 10 parachute jumps.
Yeah, I kind of gave that one away, didn't I?
You did. Yes. Gave it away early on. 74% think that. But 57% think you can drive a heavy goods vehicle, Tam. Is that true?
Well, we did have a family car that was quite big, but it wasn't actually a lorry.
So... And it's 50-50 on whether you are actually a trained lifeguard or not.
Oh, wow. Okay, so I'm not. I'm not a lifeguard. I don't have an HGV, but I think I would be really good at driving a lorry. I am a good driver.
Very good. Great. So we've got now a poll about Bill. Oh, my goodness, Bill, you're on the spot. Bill is not Bill's real name.
No.
Bill, don't say what it is yet, Bill. Bill, okay. Is it Mark Robert Bailey? Is it Charleston Wyatt Bailey, William Anthony Bailey, Christopher Jeremiah Bailey, or Wolfgang Amadeus Bailey? What do you think? Okay.
It's definitely.
Okay.
Okay. We'll see what they think about that, and we'll come back to that. Tam, could you tell me a bit about stage presence? You just mentioned it in your answer to the other thing. How do you walk onto a stage and command authority or presence?
Well, that's quite a difficult question. I think it's going back to something that Bill said about the confidence. It's something, you know, the more you do something, the more you practice it, the more your body takes over. So you then don't have to convince yourself that you can do it. So, you know, juggling, you don't have to think about where to place the balls. Your body takes over. So it's about the discipline, the doing of it over and over. So you then get a confidence in yourself. But I also really like that word because at its root, it's got the sense of confiding in it. So what you're doing is that when you walk onto a stage, you're confiding in yourself that I think you're all right doing this. But also you then trust that you are going to confide your character story with the audience. So you're then inviting an audience to have confidence to confide in you as well.
Amazing. What about you, Bill? How do you ever think about being physically confident on stage, or is it just something that's so natural to you now it's not conscious?
No, it's something that you learn over time, certainly. I mean, you learn to be able to control your nerves as well. I mean, sometimes, you know, you just before you go on stage, you do get the nerves, you get butterflies in your stomach, but gradually over the years, I've learned to be able to control that, channel it into energy and to focus. And that I find is something which is very, very useful, being able to channel all of those feelings of nerves. So, I mean, I don't tend to get nervous before a show now, but I tend to get adrenaline. The adrenaline starts to flow, and that's good. You need that. You need that little bit of extra pep when you go on stage. You want to be able to sort of, as Tamsin says, you want to be able to command the stage. You want to be able to let people know, oh, okay, look, I see, yeah, I can trust. They know what they're doing. I can relax now and enjoy this. And very often, what I've tended to do over the years, if I'm playing in a venue, I like to go and sit in the audience and actually imagine watching myself on the stage. I know it sounds a bit odd, but actually I found it really helpful. I imagined myself into the role of the audience, and I would go and sit in various parts of the theater or whatever venue it was, and just so imagine myself having gone for a night out to watch some comedy and what I might be thinking, and just the stage and taking in the atmosphere of the place, so that when I go on stage, I have a little bit of that in my head, thinking, I'm doing what I do, but I also am a little bit aware of everyone here, what they might be thinking, what view they're taking in, how the experience is for them.
I was given a lovely bit of advice by one director that I worked with, who said that, particularly like something like Shakespeare, where the words are so well known, that you should play, when you walk on stage, you're playing for two specific people. The person who has never heard these words before, or heard this music or heard seen this scenario before, and the ones the person who will never hear these words again. This is the last time they will hear this story or hear this music or be moved in a profound way, hopefully. It's about really being conscious when you walk on stage or onto a performance space of this is the only time this is happening for these people. And there's something really deep about that.
That's true. It's true because sometimes, you know, every performance, even if it's a show where you know the words, you know the lines, you may have performed it many times, every show is unique. Those group of people will never be that same group ever again. So the dynamic of that performance will be slightly different. It might not be radically different, but there will be something about it which makes it unique. And I always try to make every performance, there's something about it which is unique to that particular night.
Amazing, thank you. So our poll is in. I'm going to share the results and we're going to find out what Bill's real name is. So most people think your real name is, 42% think William Anthony Bailey. Do you want to tell us what the answer is, Bill?
I voted for Wolfgang Amadeus, so I was wrong. it's actually Mark Robert Bailey. So there we are.
That's pretty good. So 36% were right. Why did Bill come about then?
Well, Bill, I mean, it's a nickname, and it comes from a very old song called Won't You Come Home, Bill Bailey. And it was very popular at the beginning of the 20th century. And it's a sort of a jaunty, kind of jazzy, I'll play it for you. It goes like this, it goes, oh, won't you come home, Bill Bailey, won't you come home? You've been away too long. You know, it's a jaunty jazz song. It became a standard amongst jazz bands throughout the whole 20th century. And so when I was at school, my teacher, he just called me Bill. He saw the nickname, the surname, Bailey. And he said, oh, look, it's Bill Bailey. And, you know, all these kids like, what are you talking about? You know, never heard of this song. And it stuck. It sort of stuck. And everyone calls me Bill now. Except my dad. My dad, he refuses to call me Bill. It's not your name. It's not your name. Mark is your name. Hang on. I'm going to do an impersonation of my dad. It's not your name. I'm not going to call you that. It's Mark. So there. And I'm always Mark when I go and see him. In fact, my mother, she didn't like the name. She didn't smoke a pipe, by the way. My mother, if people phoned up and say, when I was at home and friends would phone up and say, hello, go speak to Bill, like that. And she would say, there's no Bill here. And she'd put the phone down. So,
Is that why it took you such a long time to get a girlfriend?
Yes, that was one of the reasons. Thank you for that, Tamsin.
Your mum was just being very protective, that was all.
Yeah, that's it, yeah.
Okay, we've got another poll come in about Tamsin now. She's got a guilty food pleasure, which is eating crusty bread dipped in honey, salad cream, Marmite, ketchup, or cold tea.
Okay.
What does she like about that? We'll see. So we've got some questions coming in. Bill, there's a question for you about how did you come up with the idea of Cockney music and putting it into classical music?
Oh, right. Well, the thing is, when I first came to London, I studied at London University, Westfield College. And it was my first real kind of experience of London. And I loved it, absolutely loved it. And I wanted to sort of like know about it, everything about it. And then I heard this duo called Chaz and Dave. And they were a sort of a musical duo. They're brilliant musicians. And they do this sort of like kind of, it's sort of jaunty kind of pub music. Anyway, so I identified certain traits of this kind of music. And I sort of isolated them. And then for a bit of fun, I tried to sort of see whether they would appear in certain classical works. And of course, if you're with a bit of imagination, you can make them work. One of them was the Cockney intro, which is, oi, like that. And this occurs, I found it occurred in Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata. So it was a bit of fun. It was a bit of, I think it started off with me wanting to find connections with different styles of music. That was the reason.
Great. Well, there's that's out there on the internet to watch. It's a really great sequence. If anyone wants to go and watch it, it's good fun. Okay, Tam, the poll is in. Let me share the results of the poll, which say that most people think it's honey, 29% honey, 12% salad cream, 18% Marmite, 20% ketchup, and 21% cold tea. So do you want to put us out of our misery and tell us what the answer is?
Wow. Well, what I love is the fact that very few people guessed it. It is actually the worst thing on that list. It's salad cream. It's the... I know, it's really, really bad. It tastes bad, it's not good for you. I mean, animals probably die making it, but I mean, I don't think the animals make it, but it's, I mean, it really takes me back to my childhood growing up in a pit of horribleness in Kilburn. But crusty white bread dipped in salad cream was my...
I put cold tea. I voted cold tea. I thought that's the sort of thing you might do.
Oh, that's a bit too posh for me.
Maybe it is.
Well, talking of posh, here's a poll for Bill. Bill loves crisps and chocolates, but his favourite are Pringles and Snickers, Frazzles and Maltesers, Wotsits and Mars Bars, or Twiglets and Twix.
Oh.
Do we think about that?
Are you voting, Bill, in your own poll?
Yes, I'm voting in my own poll. I can do that, can't I?
Of course you can, yeah. Help yourself. That's what it's there for. Right, Tam, while everybody's voting on that, I've got a great question for you, which is from Elias. Have you ever lost your composure on the stage or made a big mistake? I think maybe that's one for both of you, but do you want to go first, Tam?
Well, mercifully, when I was working with Bill on Black Books, because we knew that we could just retake stuff, that was really good for me because I found being around Bill and Dylan really, really difficult. And I used to go home at the end of rehearsals and pretend that I had a really difficult day because it was long and tiring and everything. And then I would actually secretly admit, I'm working with Bill Bailey and Dylan Moran. This literally, I couldn't be having a happier time. But when we were filming, I found it very hard not to laugh particularly around Bill. But his nostrils flare when he gets really intense about things. And I used to see...
Did they?
Used to make me, they did. That's it. There we go. There they are. That used to make me laugh a lot. And so I didn't control myself very well. But we could. But on stage, I have actually had to walk off stage and hide and then come back on stage just in time for my line, even though I was still in the scene. I did a play a couple of years ago with Martin Freeman, and he did a very funny thing with some squirty cream in his armpit, and it was a really rubbish joke, but he did it so well, and every time he got me, and I'd just walk off stage. I'd walk off and then come back on. And sometimes I came back on and then had to leave again. It was bad, really bad. I shouldn't be in this job. It's bad.
Very.
You didn't ever laugh, Bill. You're really controlled.
No, that's right. I did once. No, it was when there was a scene where we were all sitting in a cafe. This is in Black Books. And there's a scene where I have to sort of... I keep putting sugar lumps into my tea and my coffee, and I keep putting more and more sugar lumps into the coffee. And Dylan were sitting there going, "Are you nervous?" And I'm going, "No, I'm not nervous. I'm not nervous." And the gag was, the camera would go around, and I have a huge, like a pyramid of sugar lumps in my coffee. But of course, the thing is that if you put sugar lumps in cold coffee, as it was, they dissolve. They dissolve. So this gag of having a pile of sugar lumps, the sugar cubes, it wasn't going to work. They kept sort of collapsing in. So what they did was, the props department, unbeknownst to me, was they filled the coffee cup up to the level of the coffee with nuts and bolts, right? It's the only thing that they could find to fill the coffee cup so that it so that the sugar lumps would rest on the nuts and bolts, right? I don't know why that was the only thing they had around. But they didn't tell me. And then they said, right, okay, we fixed it. Okay, everyone, ready, go again, ready, and action. So I was going, I'm not nervous. I put all the sugar lumps in, and then I picked up the cup, and the cup weighed a ton. It weighed like 20 times more than it weighed 5 seconds ago. And I went, I'm not nervous. And then I went to pick up the cup, like, I couldn't lift it. And I just struggled. My hand was shaking. And then all the sugar lamps fell off, and then I started laughing. But I thought, what a great trick to play on someone in a play. Wouldn't that be brilliant? Where somebody has to, like, pour a cup of tea and then take a drink of tea and, like, you put some lead weights in the bottom of the tea and watch them struggle with it. Oh, that would be... Anyway, that's when that got me laughing.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun. It was very joyous.
It was.
Great. So let's. The end of the poll is here. So let's share the results. Most people think it's Pringles and Snickers, although the others have come quite. 26% for Twiglets and Twix, 22% for Wotsits and Mars Bars, and 21% for Frazzles and Maltesers. So Frazzles and Maltesers are actually at the bottom. What's the answer, Bill?
Well, I tricked you. It's Frazzles and Maltesers.
Hold on a minute. Frazzles, you're a vegetarian.
Yeah, but there's no... They are actually vegetarian.
But you want your food to taste of meat.
Yes. Frazzles, there's no meat in them. It's just flavouring.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you'd like to eat pig, though.
Well, I mean, at one stage, yes. But, you know, I like it. Just, you get a hint of pig.
A hint of pig, please.
A hint of pig. A memory. A memory of pig. I remember pigs. Remember them? Lovely things. Anyway,
sorry to interrupt you. I know you're having a lot of fun, but I just want to share a little screen of what everybody's been up to at NCO, because we've been up to lots of fun things because we've got this digital program going on at the moment. So this is for all our NCO kids out there. Let's see what you've been up to. So we obviously had our webinar on Wednesday. It was called There's No I in Team, and these are all amazing orchestral musicians telling us how the teamwork thing works within orchestras. And so we had some lovely webinar selfies from you all, and we want a lot more of those today. Any minute now we're going to do another one with Bill and Tam, so those are going to be a lot of fun. So thank you so much for doing that and sharing those. I'm sorry we can't share all of them here. Now, you've been having sectional fun, so there's some of our little cellos. We've got about 450 kids on this program, Bill and Tam, so it's a massive program of young musicians across the country. There's some violins having a bit of fun, then some really little trombonists having fun, and tuba players. And look, the flutes there, they've made a little house, I think, out of their flutes. You can see that. I think a little bit of choreography going on. We're putting together a great big multi-tracked mambo for the end of this program, and it's got some choreography in it. So I imagine that's what the trombones are doing. They're practicing their choreography. Maybe that's what the horns are doing too. I'm not sure. They look like they're having fun anyway. I love the horns. And there's our flutes joining themselves up again as well. That's the youngest flute players that we have. And you've been doing our listening tasks, which are all on the website. So this is a beautiful picture by Finn in response to some of the music in the listening tasks. Now, there's a pick and mix bit on our website, which has got lots of fun things. So you've been making musical masks for your friends out there to keep everybody fit and healthy. And those are lovely. And I'm super excited about these. We're just starting to get these. Have you ever done any of these, Bill? Multi-track things like a cappella?
No, I haven't.
No, okay. So basically you record yourself over yourself over yourself to create a collage effect. And Finn here on the left is doing a really beautiful happy birthday, which would be such a gem for somebody to receive on their birthday. And Aaron is doing What Should We Do With the Lazy Pirate or something like that, with in costume and everything. So those are great. And Mission Escape, somebody's found the Mission Escape. So that's there on the website. Have a look for that. And the Pick and Mix Taskmaster challenge, they've been going on as well. This was a challenge to bring something really unusual out of your instrument case. So we've had some really properly unusual things coming out. This is a great video. Check Revin's video out. It's all, they're all on the gallery on the website, so have a little check of those. And a few pets coming out of instrument cases. So there's Jasmine and her rabbit. And here are the chickens.
Chickens
from the Jacobs family. So that brings us neatly to our conversation. Oh, they're actually all on the gallery, so go and have a look at them. To our little conversation now about your pets, guys. I know we're running out of time, but we're having too much fun. Are you all right to carry on for a few more minutes? Okay, good. So here's the pets. So Tam, tell us about your pets.
Well, we have one pet who I didn't want a pet. I didn't want a dog. And it took 10 years of wearing down by my children. And finally, my daughter made 3 PowerPoint presentations about why it was important for us to get a dog. And so we caved in, and this little creature came to live with us last year. This is a cockapoo called Zoe. And the one when she's on my lap just there, she'd just been shorn. So she was sort of in shock and wouldn't get off my lap because I think she was just trying to suck my body heat out of her. But now, of course, in lockdown, she's just been the best thing ever, going out on walks with her. Oh, we also now do have other pets called fleas.
Oh.
And what about Bill? So I did ask Bill for a selection of his pets, so perhaps you can talk us through these then, Bill.
Oh, okay. Well, they, on the left there, that's Jakob. And she's a cockatoo, a Triton cockatoo from Papua New Guinea. And on the right is Molly, and she's a Moluccan cockatoo from the island of Seram in Indonesia. And they're best pals, and they've just got a new toy there. And these are rescue birds, which were birds that meant that they were in a collection or an animal collection or a zoo, and they couldn't look after them anymore. So we run a sort of a... We have a kind of an animal rescue centre in our house, in our garden, and it's, so they've taken over a bit, as you'll probably see. Anyway, this is just 2 of them, and they're great fun. Well, that's, yeah, on the left, that's the garden here in my office. You can see there's ducks there, 2 giant rabbits, a tortoise, some chickens. That's just a kind of small petting zoo area. And on the right, those are 2 of the large, that's a Malay hen and a Malay cockerel. And you can see they look a bit bemused. And that's because they wandered into the house one day and then got lost and wandered into the bathroom. That's them in the shower. They're actually standing in the shower. And I went in, I was like, what the hell? And they looked a bit bemused. So that's... that's Luna. That's our newest cockatoo. And she's comes from, and there's a whole armful of them there. And on the left, that's Banjar, the rescue dog. There we've got, and that's Tiger. He's another rescue. And he doesn't like being photographed. He's very nervous. So I only got that on a long lens. So I just sort of snap him like a paparazzi. And you can see, look at him. He's looking at me like, what's that? And these are our ducks. And they're sleeping on the pond.
Wow, so you've got a right royal zoo at home, haven't you?
Oh, yes, absolutely.
Amazing. So just before we wind up and do our selfie, let me share what's happening next week. On Wednesday, our Wednesday webinar next week is with the Olympic athlete Claire Bennett, who's a fencer, the harpist Anne Denham, and the performance coach Tom Taffender. And we're talking about how you can be the best you can be. So performance psychology and all those things. So don't forget to come and join us for that. So I think we're so running out of time, we need to think about our selfie. So have you got anything you want to use, Bill, or Tam, because I've got a nice hat that I found earlier.
Oh, okay. I have hats. I'll do a picture with a little bird.
Perfect. Oh, you got your guitar. Excellent, Bill.
No, I've got this. Oh, it's one of my favourite things. It's a flying V ukulele.
Perfect. Great. Okay, so we're going to do a countdown. So the kids can... Oh, perfect. So the kids can do a selfie with it, okay? So 3, 2, 1. Okay, great. Right, looking forward to those. They'll come flooding in this week. You'll see them all over social media, so enjoy that. And it just leads me to say a huge thank you to you both. We could go on and on, but thank you so much for joining us and sharing some of your wisdom and a lot of your humour. And is there one final thought you perhaps could leave us with around what advice would you like to have heard when you were 12? What was the best piece of advice that you were ever given when you were younger, or something, a guiding kind of principle that's gone through your life? Do you want to start with that, Tam?
I think I would probably say to myself, but I would say to any young person who's just sort of, you know, on the brink of everything, that it, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. It'll be all right. And things will go weird and strange and difficult. They'll change shape, but don't be afraid. It'll be all right.
Great. And Bill, what about you?
Well, the most brilliant bit of advice I ever got was from my music teacher at school. I was the only A-level music student in my school. And I had this wonderful teacher, and she was absolutely a marvel, just an inspiration in so many ways. And she encouraged me to perform my first, it was a recital, a piano recital. I would never have done it without her encouragement. And basically what she said to me was, you are capable of far more than you think. And it was one of the most extraordinary things that anyone's ever said to me. And it resonates with me my whole life. I hear her voice. I've heard it throughout my whole life. When I was playing a recital in a room in Bath in front of the school governors and some parents. And then fast forward, I'm standing backstage at Wembley Arena. There's 13,500 people waiting for me to go out and do comedy. And I hear her voice saying, you're capable of more. And that's invaluable. Those little moments of wisdom stay with you a whole life. Teachers are marvellous. Respect them.
Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. It's been an inspiration, and good luck with the rest of the summer. I hope you manage to have holidays, and I hope we can welcome you back in some way to NCO at some point in the future. Thank you for your time today. Thank you.
Bye.